God's people singing together in harmony and in praise to God. What comes to mind when you think of a close friend? There are probably some names that pop into your head just by hearing the phrase. Now, we're not talking about Facebook friends. And we're not talking about a friend as opposed to an enemy. We're not talking about friends that are really only casual acquaintances. We're talking about those few people in your life that you can really totally count on. A close friendship has features that make that friendship or that relationship different from most of the other relationships in your life. When you think of those truly close friends, what terms describe that relationship? To begin with, these truly close friends are the few people in your life that no matter what happens, you know that they will be loyal and faithful and dependable. They're the people you can talk to about anything. These are the people to whom you might feel closer than even to some members of your own physical family. Several factors set these relationships apart. Trust, that's one of them. They may disagree with you, they may even disapprove of something you do, but a friend will never betray you. Respect is another part of friendship. It's hard to have a real friendship if there isn't a high level of mutual respect for one and for the other. Friends may challenge you, but they won't reject you even if they know your greatest weaknesses. In these lessons on Sunday evening, we're looking at conversations that people had with God. A couple weeks ago, we looked at the conversation that Adam and Eve had with God in the garden after they had sinned. This evening, we're looking at one of the conversations that Abraham had with God. According to 2 Chronicles, chapter 20 and verse 7, Abraham and God were friends. That text says, "Are you not our God, who drove out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel, and gave it to the descendants of Abraham, your friend forever?" This idea that Abraham was God's friend is repeated in Isaiah chapter 41 and again over in James chapter 2. So I would say it is a firmly established biblical fact. Not too many people are called the friend of God. In fact, I think Abraham is maybe the only one. And it's a stunning statement. If someone were looking for a way to describe you, let's say, put on your tombstone, your epitaph, and they put, "He was a friend of God." That would be good. That'd be hard to beat. I can't think of any higher compliment than that one. The conversation recorded in Genesis chapter 18 reflects that friendship between God and Abraham. That God felt compelled to discuss his plans for Sodom with Abraham is already a somewhat unique situation. And the way the conversation unfolded, with Abraham dickering with God as if he were at a flea market, and God allowing the conversation to go that way, is a testimony to the friendship between the two of them. We tend to be more patient with our friends than we are with other people. So we can learn, I think, some useful lessons about our relationship with God, by looking at the conversation between these two friends. Before getting into the text, though, I want to read the first stanza of the hymn, "My God and I." Now, normally, whenever we sing that song, my mind almost automatically goes to the scene of God walking in the garden looking for Adam and Eve. And it may well be an accurate description of their relationship before the time when he came after they had sinned. But when we think of Abraham, the friend of God, this song really does seem like an accurate portrayal of that friendship. "My God and I go in the fields together. We walk and talk. as good friends should and do. We clasp our hands. Our voices ring with laughter. My God and I walk through the meadows hue. Even allowing for some poetic license, we should seek that intimacy and that comfort in our relationship with God. In Genesis chapter 18, there is something about the relationship that caused God to stop and say, I really should talk with Abraham before I go ahead with this. In Genesis 18, verses 17 and 18, the Lord said, shall I hide from Abraham what I am doing? Since Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him. This is a tremendous tribute to Abraham. God was going to destroy the city where Abraham's nephew Lot lived. But God didn't need Abraham's consent or approval before he did that. God was under no obligation to Abraham concerning Lot or concerning the city of Sodom. For example, Lot was indeed a member of Abraham's extended family, but the promise that God had made to Abraham about his descendants being greater than the sands of the sea, that didn't directly affect Lot. He could fulfill that promise even if Lot was totally out of the picture. And we can actually trace in Genesis something of the development of this friendship through the various conversations that are recorded. God's first conversation with Abraham is told in Genesis chapter 12. I'll just read a verse that summarizes it. It doesn't actually give the conversation. So Abram departed as the Lord had spoken to him, and Lot went with him, and Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. This is back right at the beginning of Genesis chapter 12. This is the first time that we have a conversation with him. God simply told Abraham to move to a foreign land, and Abraham moved to a foreign land. We might call it a conversation, I just did, but actually there's no actual record of Abraham saying anything. His response is seen only in his obedience to what God said to him. It was sort of a one-sided conversation, you might say. In chapter 13, we have a similar conversation. Genesis 13, verse 14, to get it going. And the Lord said to Abram, after Lot had separated from him, lift your eyes now and look from the place where you are, northward, southward, eastward, and westward. And then down in verse 17, he's continuing, arise, walk in the land through its length and its width, for I give it to you. God told Abraham to walk around Palestine and see the land that God would someday give to Abraham's descendants. Once again, we have no verbal response from Abraham recorded in the text. God said, walk. Abraham walked. But before we get to the conversation over in chapter 18, there are a couple other conversations that are recorded. In Genesis 15, God appeared to Abraham in a vision. Verse 1, after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your exceedingly great reward. And this is the first time that we know for sure that Abraham gave a verbal response. Verse 2, but Abram said, Lord God, what will you give me, seeing I go childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus? Abraham's answer is actually a request for more information. And we can identify with that. We often want God to give us a bit more information about what he has told us to do and why he has told us to do it. In Genesis 17, God appeared and spoke to Abraham again. In this conversation, it's a little bit give and take, but God spoke a lot. Abraham only said a very few words. But again, Abraham was asking for more information about how this old man and woman were going to have a natural born son. And in this case, God patiently answered and reassured Abraham about the promise. By the time we get to Genesis 18, the relationship has developed to the point where we find God sort of just dropping by Abraham's tent since he happened to be in the neighborhood. The scene is described as three men traveling, and Abram showed them hospitality. It turns out that two of the men are apparently angels. The third is the Lord. Before getting down to the real purpose of the visit, they exchange in some small talk about the baby that God had been promising to Abraham and to Sarah. We are a bit intrigued by figuring out just the difference there may have been, how you could figure out which one was the Lord and the other two men were maybe angels. They're generally called men in this story. But that curiosity can easily become a distraction from the real message. In Genesis 18, verse 17, we read this earlier, but we'll read it again. There's an intriguing part of the conversation. And the Lord said, "Shall I hide from Abraham what I'm doing?" Is God talking to himself? Or is he talking to the other two men? Or does Abraham hear this statement as well as the other things God says? It sounds like, well, whoever heard it, that the Lord is sending the other two men ahead so that he can stop and have a more private conversation with Abraham. After talking about the baby that God had promised them, the two men left and God talked to Abraham about his plans for Sodom. Abraham understood that if Sodom was as evil as its reputation, God could justly destroy the city. He either knew or suspected that the evil reputation was fully deserved. And it's interesting in that light that Abraham tried to negotiate for the whole city rather than just intervening on behalf of, let me get a Lot and his family out. He tries to save the whole city in his negotiation. And in the end, that's what happened. Lot was evacuated and the rest of the city was destroyed. But as the story goes, Abraham starts negotiating to save the city. He starts somewhat timidly, setting a break point at 50 righteous people. But as he thinks more and more about the reputation of Sodom, he seems to sense that 50's not going to cut it. So we have almost a humorous situation of Abraham shaving the numbers. He finally asks God to spare the city if they can find only 10 righteous people. At that point, Abraham doesn't try God's patience any further. And in the meantime, the two men who had been with the Lord have arrived in Sodom and warned Lot to get out of town. Finally, Lot, his wife, two daughters are the only ones who evacuate. So even if Abraham had gone on down to 5 righteous souls, the city would still have been doomed. Through the story, we can see some significant lessons about God and how He approaches His relationships with us. First of all, God took the initiative. Throughout history, God has always taken the initiative in the God-man relationship. Even earlier, way back there when he first talked to Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, he didn't have to make any promise to Abraham. The promise was God's initiative. He didn't have to tell Abraham anything about his plans for Sodom. He didn't have to give Abraham a chance to help Lot escape from Sodom. The conversation, in fact, the entire relationship existed because God acted first. He took the initiative. Any relationship we have with God is dependent on what God has already done and on His willingness and on His desire to have a relationship with us. Fundamentally, this is what we call grace, just describing it somewhat differently than we normally do. God didn't have to give us the Bible. He doesn't have to listen to our prayers. We have those forms of communication because God acted first. And we are inclined to seek God because of what God has already done for us. When we talk with God, when we serve God in any way, we do well to think about His initiatives that have preceded what we are considering doing. Everything we ever say to God, everything we ever say to God is a response to something He has already done. Maybe a bad response, but it's a response. Usually it's good, let's hope. Whether we thank God or argue with God, it's because of what He has done and His willingness to be patient with us. So ideally, we should acknowledge our dependence on His reaching out to us and His kindness towards us. Second, when Abraham started bargaining with God, how did God respond? And maybe we can start with the question, how would we expect God to respond? He could have said, Abraham, save your breath. I know what Sodom is like, and I know they aren't going to change, so I'm going to destroy them. He could have said, who are you to question my plans? But Abraham was his friend, so God listened. As Abraham bargained, God went along with that. We even get the impression that God wanted to say yes, if at all possible, to what his friend requested. He wanted to give his friend Abraham what Abraham wanted. Sodom deserved the punishment that God had planned, but God was willing to spare the city because his friend asked him to do so. I don't know exactly how this line of thought will work out in our own life situations, but the principle is biblical. When we ask God for something, He wants to say yes. But sometimes, as much as He wants to give us what we ask, it isn't possible or it won't work, so He doesn't say yes, but He wants to. God knew how this conversation was going to end before it even started, but He still let Abraham go through the process of making his request and learning for himself just what the situation was. We also see an example of God's patience with a friend. Sometimes we like to imagine scenarios of what we would do if we were God. So let's try that for a moment. If you had been God, how long would you have gone along with Abraham's futile effort to save Sodom? He could have rejected the request outright. We're not even going to talk about even 50 righteous souls. He could have cut Abraham off by telling them right away that there weren't 50 or there weren't 40 or there weren't even 10 righteous souls in the city. He could have said that his mind was made up. Would you have gone down to 40? Would you have gone down to 30? I'm very certain that I would have run out of patience sooner than God did. God knew the outcome, but He was still patient with His friend. In our relationship with God, He is always amazingly patient with us. How often do we ask Him for things that aren't good? Or we ask for the wrong reasons. And He could certainly decide that we should have understood His will better by now, so why are we bothering Him with this stuff? If God were not patient, none of us would be asking Him anything because we would already be crisp toast. Throughout the story, though, we also learn about how a friend talks with God. One element of the conversation is that as Abraham talked to God, he knew that his request was in some way compatible with God's will. He wasn't asking something that he knew outright That's totally outside of anything God would ever consider doing. He wasn't doing that. He didn't know the details of God's dealings with Sodom through the years. He probably didn't have a perfect understanding of God's way of balancing mercy and justice. But he knew the nature of God, even that Old Testament God. He knew that saving sinners was something that God really wanted to do. So let's look at Abraham's reasoning. Chapter back in Genesis 18, verses 24 and 25. Suppose there were 50 righteous within the city. Would you also destroy the place and not spare it for the 50 righteous that were in it? Far be it from you to do such a thing as this, to slay the righteous with the wicked, so that the righteous should be as the wicked. Far be it from you. Shall not the judge of all the earth do right? Abraham knew that God was a just God and a merciful God. He knew that God would prefer to save than to destroy. How often do we think that God should do something about some bad, evil things that are going on? We want Him to punish evil. We want Him to take care of bad people. But He still wants to save. Abraham's request was based on his faith in the goodness of God. We actually have a close parallel with this over in 1 John chapter 5. In 1 John chapter 5, verses 15 and 16, we read, And if we know that He hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we have asked of Him. If anyone sees his brother sinning a sin which does not lead to death, he will ask, and He will give him life for those who commit sin not leading to death. There is sin leading to death. I don't say to pray about, that you should pray about that. All righteousness is sin, but there is sin not leading to death. First, we have the promise that God answers our prayers in this passage in 1 John. Then He gives us an example of asking God to forgive someone who deserves to be punished. That's exactly what Abraham was asking. Abraham knew that Sodom was Sin City, but he asked God to spare them anyway, and God heard him out. As God's friend, Abraham knew that what he was asking was the type of thing that God liked to do. He liked to spare sinners. In addition, we have to be impressed with Abraham's boldness. Abraham pushed the limits. I wonder how many other people could have gotten by with this. Now, according to some other Bible stories, we have the suggestion that some others could. Job, with his complaining for, 38 out of 40 chapters, would fit Gideon's fleece test, would suggest that God's patience isn't limited to Abraham. But starting with 50 and then asking for an 80% discount is some serious bargaining. But friends can do that with each other. We can be daring with our friends. We can ask them things we wouldn't dare ask someone else. We know that they'll hear us out, if only to be polite. And remember, this wasn't the first conversation that Abraham had with God. God had promised him a son. Abraham had questioned that the promise was possible. So he already knew that he could speak openly with God. He knew that he could ask God things. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19 tells us that we can come before God with boldness. We have boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus. Boldness, though, doesn't mean disrespectful, but it means that we can say what we really think, what we have on our hearts. Abraham was bold because he knew God, because he believed in God's goodness, because he had a friendship that went back several years. We can approach God with confidence because we know how much He loves us. Or we have a good idea of it. Maybe we don't fully appreciate it, but we know it. Bold he was, but Abraham was also humble. At all times in this conversation, even bargaining down from 50 to 10, Abraham was acutely aware of whom he was talking to. God was his friend, but he was still God. We see this clearly in Genesis 18, verse 27. Then Abraham answered and said, "Indeed, now, I who am but dust and ashes have taken it upon myself to speak to the Lord." Abraham never forgot who was in charge. Again, in his last request, Abraham trusted God's patience, but he acknowledged God's supremacy. Verse 32, and he said, "Let not the Lord be angry, and I will speak but once more. Suppose 10 should be found there." And he said, "I will not destroy it for the sake of 10. There was nothing flippant or presumptuous in anything that Abraham said. Even in asking God to spare Sodom, Abraham was acknowledging that no one could stop God if God didn't want to be stopped. No one could destroy as God could, and no one could save as God could. Sometimes we ask God for stuff. Sometimes we beat ourselves up over that a bit, saying we're asking all the time and never thanking Him. But at least even in the asking, even if we ask too often and too much, we are at least in the asking acknowledging that we are dependent on Him if He's going to give it to us or not. When Abraham asked God to spare Sodom, Abraham acknowledged that the final decision depended on God and on God alone. It would only change if God allowed it to change. In spite of their previous conversations, this was still a learning experience for Abraham. He trusted God to be patient and be merciful. His trust was confirmed. It was strengthened. He also saw a confirmation of God's justice. Even as he bargained with God, Abraham seems to have appreciated the fact that if God went ahead and destroyed Sodom, it was not out of meanness. He knew that Sodom deserved what God was planning to do. But when he saw the smoke rising from the city the next day, he had confirmation that God must be just. Without God even explaining it to him, he knew that God had not been able to find even those 10 righteous souls. Abraham's intervention was based on his belief that if he asked and made a good case, he could get God to change his plans. But in the end, it was actually Abraham who changed. And that's the way prayer often works. We're praying to get God to change something, and He changes us. After the conversation, Abraham surely understood better than ever how patient his friend was. He was also confirmed in his knowledge that God can and will punish evil. Evil will not prevail. That's threatening at times when we are the evildoers, but it's also reassuring most of the time. God wouldn't be much of a God if He couldn't punish when punishment is just. We can ask God whatever we want, and we grow when we accept His answer as being the best possible answer. And I think Abraham acknowledged that that was the case here. We think of God in many different ways. God, Creator, Judge, Lord, Savior, probably several more. All of those are good. But we should also think of Him as our friend, or at least our potential friend. He wants to be our friend. But to be His friend, we should follow the example of Abraham, who trusted God and consistently did what God told him to do. God has shown us how much He wants to be our friend by sending His own Son to die for our sins. So we need to believe that He has really done that for us. And then we need to repent of the sins that damage our relationship with Him. And we need to be baptized, because God has promised that He will forgive our sins when we're baptized. If you need and want that relationship with God, and or you want to renew your friendship with God, and we can help you do that, let's stand and sing. Let us know.